Well, hello everyone. This is Mike Howard, and I am here with
Beverly Howard.
We're going to do a Bible study. We're starting a 9-year journey. Wow.
9 years.
That's amazing, okay? Ooh. Lifeway divides the Bible, all 66 books, into a 9-year study, and today we're beginning one of those 9-year cycles. And we're going to start with the Gospel of Mark. So get ready. It's going to be a great study. We're in session one. This is titled Introduced. And Mark chapter 1, verses 1 through 13 are our focal passage. So it's the Gospel of Mark. Now, of course, if you're a Christian and you've been one for a while, you know that there are four Gospels and that the job of those Gospels is to introduce us to this person called Jesus, who is the promised and long-awaited Messiah. He is the King who would save God's people from their sins. That's what Gabriel announced to Mary. He is both the Son of Man from the line of David, King David, and he is, of course, the Son of God. So the Gospels, all four of them, introduce us to this wonderful Messiah, Jesus Christ. So the Gospels, it's called Gospels because that Greek word is translated gospel, or it's the Greek word is gospel, it's translated as good news. And we know that the four are Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. Those are the first four books of the New Testament. Now, Matthew, Mark, and Luke are very similar in the way they approach describing Jesus and his life and his ministry, his death and his resurrection. And because they're so close, they're called the synoptic or similar or the same gospels. Now, Mark, starting about 150 years ago, now in the beginning, back 1,000, 1,500 years ago, it was believed that Matthew was the first gospel. But since then, we've come to understand that Mark, in fact, was the first gospel written. So good news, we're studying the first gospel of the four. It was written first, drawing from mostly eyewitness accounts from the apostle Peter, while Peter and Mark were both in Rome. Matthew and Luke, however, used Mark's material and supplemented that material with additional eyewitness sources. Luke, in the beginning of Luke, he says that he went out and scoured for all the different sources that he would use in the writing of the book of Luke. So synoptic means a lot of it's the same. So 91% of the verses in Mark can be found in the book of Matthew.
Wow, that's a lot.
That's a lot, yeah. Okay? 53% of the verses in Mark can be found in the book of Luke. Of the total 665 verses that are found in the book of Mark, 600 of those appear in some form in Matthew or Luke.
Wow.
And that comes, those statistics come from the Zondervan Study Bible, the Introduction to the Gospel. So I take their word for it. So the timing of the Gospels, both Paul and Peter are in Rome in the 60s, that's the 60 ADs. Both, however, were killed towards the end of the 60s by Emperor Nero because he blamed the Christians and the Jews for the great fire that was in Rome. So there was a lot of persecution that broke out about the time that Mark wrote this gospel. The synoptic, all three of the synoptic gospels, they think, were written in the 60s or maybe as late as the early 70s. However, John, which is similar but very different than the synoptic gospels, they believe that it was written in the 80s. So, late 60s, early 70s. That's the time frame. And really what we're talking about here is how do these gospels fit into the whole birth of the church, the birth of Christianity. Okay, so Jesus was born. We reset our calendars. He was born somewhere around zero, maybe plus three or plus four. We don't know for sure. He was crucified after he lived 33 years. So he was crucified in 33 or so AD. And then the early churches created by the apostles, including Paul with his missionary journeys, started up between 33, that would be when Christ was resurrected, and 70 AD. So that's a period of history of the churches. Nero begins his persecution, as I mentioned earlier, and the Gospels are written about the same time. Not long after The Jews revolted and Rome destroyed Jerusalem. That was in 70 AD. It wasn't until then that the Roman Empire really began to view Christians as different from Jews. Okay, up to that point in time, they were viewed as kind of a sect of Judaism. But once Rome destroyed Jerusalem, Christianity became enough different that Romans, the whole Roman Empire, began to call these people Christians. It's very interesting to me that Jesus said all of this would happen in one generation. And we know that the Bible says that you're promised 70 years, which is 70 years. So from the time of his birth until the time Jerusalem was destroyed and the church was really considered the church by non-Jewish people, it was 70 years. It all happened in one lifespan. It is an amazingly fast thing. God did that in a hurry. Mm-hmm. Not in a hurry, but he did it quickly. Okay, so who was John Mark? He's the one that we think wrote this gospel. He lived in Jerusalem. We find that out in Acts chapter 12. There's a story when Peter gets out of prison there. He goes and knocks on the door of Mary, who is the mother of John Mark. So we know that Peter knew John Mark all the way back then. He is also the cousin of Barnabas, and we'll find out a little more about that. In Colossians chapter 4, verse 10, it says that he's the cousin. Unfortunately for Mark, he has a little black mark on his name. He actually went with Paul and Barnabas on the first missionary tour, but they got as far as the territory of Pamphylia, and John Mark decided he wanted to go home, so he left them, and that made Paul upset, and that happened in about somewhere between around 48 AD and Acts chapter 15. So in Paul's second Roman imprisonment, however, so this just goes to show that you can do one thing wrong. Say, Paul got very upset because Barnabas wanted to ask John Mark to go with him on the second journey, and Paul absolutely refused to have anything to do with him again because he deserted him the first time. Barnabas took John Mark, they went to Cyprus, and then so Paul took, I think, Silas and took off on his second missionary journey. Okay, but years later, Paul's second Roman imprisonment, that's towards the end of his life, he asks that Mark would come to see him. That's in his last book, 2 Timothy. And Peter says that he is in Rome with Mark in 1 Peter. So John Mark became a very important person in that part of the early church history, and who better equipped, because he spends so much time with Peter. As a matter of fact, where did Mark get all of his information? Papias, who is an early church elder in the late part of the first century, says this about Mark. Mark neither heard the Lord nor followed him. In other words, he wasn't one of the original 12 disciples, but he relied upon Peter for all the information he put into his gospel. So it was from Peter. So the lesson is called Introduced. Now, we know that Mark and then later Matthew and Luke and John all introduce us to this Messiah named Jesus Christ. But each one of those gospels also introduce us to a person who introduces Jesus to his ministry. And you think of this kind of like the change of command or the passing of the gavel. As a matter of fact, the way I look at it is John the Baptist is going to pass the baton to Jesus. The old covenant is going to be ending and the new covenant is going to be beginning. This is a big deal. In the great timeline of humanity, this is a key moment. This is a moment when the old covenant is going to turn itself over to a more beautiful covenant with Christ. So we're going to get announced. We're going to start in verse 1 and go to 13. Something good, it's good news, and something new, because it is news. The beginning of the good news about Jesus, the Messiah, the Son of God. That's how Mark starts his gospel. He doesn't beat around the bush. He just tells you right up front, this is Jesus, the Messiah, the Son of God. And then he goes on to say, like all four gospel writers, he goes on to tell us about how the ministry of Jesus begins. And it begins through the person of John the Baptist. So John the Baptist is the last Old Testament prophet. Interesting. As it is written in Isaiah the prophet, I will send my messenger ahead of you who will then prepare your way. He will be a voice of one calling in the wilderness, prepare the way of the Lord, make straight paths for him. So John the Baptist has two jobs. First job is to prepare people's hearts for the coming Messiah. And the other job is to point people to the Messiah when he comes on the scene. And John does both of those beautifully well. In Isaiah chapter 40, verses 3 and 9, in verse 3, he says that John is going to prepare the way of the Lord. He's going to turn the hearts of the children to the parents and the parents to the children, okay? Isaiah 40, verse 9 says, then he is going to announce the good news. And Isaiah says this, he's going to stand up and he's going to say, here is your God. Okay, what a great thing to be able to say. One time I had the opportunity to announce the to introduce the CEO of our company at a big meeting, and I was really quite nervous about that. But my job was simply to kind of be the opening act or set the stage, really, to introduce the CEO. Well, John the Baptist takes that role very seriously. And as Jesus walks by in the Gospel of John, he says, look, there goes the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. He does a great job of telling everybody that here is your God. And so, verse 4, John the Baptist appears in the wilderness, preaching a Jordan River baptism. So this is a different baptism than the baptism of the Spirit that Jesus brings later. He says, baptism of repentance for the forgiveness of sins. John is actually doing his baptisms about the exact same spot that Joshua took the Israelites from the wilderness into the promised land. Yeah, so John the Baptist is actually baptizing these people at the same place he's about to baptize Jesus. And Jesus is going to take the real people, the new covenant people, from the wilderness of sin, into the promised land, the promised land of heaven, okay? So this is really kind of cool that he's there doing this. People who knew they were sinners. Now, this is pretty cool. The only people baptized by John the Baptist are the ones that came to him because they knew they were sinners. Now, some of the religious leaders would come out to figure out what was going on, but they weren't there to be baptized because they didn't think they had any sin. It says, the whole Judean countryside and all the people of Jerusalem went out to him, John the Baptist, confessing their sins. They were baptized by John the Baptist in the Jordan River. This is one of the ways that John prepared the hearts of people. He talked to them about their sin. They became convicted of their sins, and then they were ready to be forgiven for their sins. So he really set the road, set the stage for Jesus. He was like Elijah the prophet. John wore clothing made of camel's hair with a leather belt around his waist, and he ate locusts and honey. If you go back to 1 Kings, some people saw this guy with camel's hair, a coat or robe, and wearing a leather belt. And he told them some things about the king. So they went to tell the king. The king said, well, what did he look like? And they told him, he says, oh, well, that was easy. That's Elijah the prophet. Okay. So John the Baptist dressed and behaved just like Elijah the prophet. And he was, of course, in the spirit of Elijah. Get ready for the Messiah, John says. This was his message. So if you want to know the message that John the Baptist preached, here it is. It's in verse 7. John says this. He says, after me. So he's already pointing to the Messiah. After me comes the one who is what? More powerful than I, the straps of whose sandals I am not worthy to stoop down and untie. So he says, after me, I'm here to baptize you in water, okay? But there's going to come one after me. He's talking about the Messiah, who is not only more powerful, but also more worthy to do the baptism. And then he says this, I just baptize you with water, which is basically just going to cleanse you of sins for a little while, because you're going to go back to your life, and sooner or later you're going to sin again. But this Jesus, this Messiah, he's going to baptize you with the Holy Spirit, and that's going to be an eternal baptism, and that will change your heart. The stage then is set for Jesus the Messiah. So Mark's going to shift his vision here. Now that he's told us all about John, he's going to say, at that time, Jesus came from Nazareth in Galilee, which is where, of course, he grew up, and was baptized by John in the Jordan River. It's interesting that Jesus chose to be baptized. I've always wondered, why did Jesus tell John that he needed to be baptized? And I think it's because Jesus needed to be the Messiah, to die for our sins, Jesus had to put himself under the law. And to be under the law, he had to be baptized in the Jordan River water. He had to come through that water the same way that the Israelites did. Okay, my opinion. Thank you. This was a sign promised to John. Okay, so when John baptized Jesus, even though they were cousins and they probably knew each other from various family things, John the Baptist had been out in the wilderness for probably 20 years, maybe 15, okay? Hadn't seen Jesus in a long time. And, you know, I don't know what he thought when he saw Jesus, but when he saw what happens next, he knew exactly who Jesus was. And just as Jesus was coming up out of the water from being baptized, John the Baptist saw heaven being torn open and the Spirit descended on Jesus like a dove. And then a voice came from heaven saying, "You are my son whom I love. With you I am well pleased." And we read in the other Gospels that John said, "God told me ahead of time that when that happened, that would be the chosen Messiah." So he knew right at that moment that Jesus was the Messiah. And then 42 times, and the Gospel of Mark's pretty short, okay? And Mark moves along in the narrative, as we're going to find out over the next few weeks. And this is the first time he says it, but he says it 41 more times. He says, "Immediately the Spirit sent Jesus out into the wilderness, and there Jesus was for 40 days being tempted by Satan. He was with wild animals, and angels attended him." So Jesus, coming up out of the water, now has the baton. It's been given to him by John. John's passed the command. It's the Old Testament to the New Testament. It's a huge change in the timeline of humanity. And now Jesus begins his ministry, and he begins it with a great temptation. So let's summarize. The Messiah, of course, in all four Gospels is introduced. He's introduced by baptism. Jesus takes control from the Old Covenant and perfectly fulfills the requirements of the law. And because he does that, he then can die on the cross being perfect, and we then can have our sins, being imperfect as we are, forgiven. He is the perfect, spotless Lamb who died for us. And this is going to begin, this baptism is going to begin his 3.5-year earthly ministry that will eventually end on the cross. When it does, the new covenant of grace, not the law, through faith, begins with that death and resurrection. So the old covenant that was handed to him by John the Baptist was flawed, and it was never going to be able to make anyone righteous. He hands that covenant to Jesus, who then fulfills it and then dies so that we can be saved through the new covenant, which is a covenant of grace, God's grace, through faith in what Jesus did. How beautiful is that story? That's not only good news, that's great news. So, but then the question comes up, and has always bothered me, is could God not have brought Jesus on the scene without John the Baptist? I mean, after all, when he was born, the angels announced him to the shepherds. The wise men came to worship him. Did God really need to have John the Baptist there? And it was so important that all four Gospels wrote about it. So let's take a closer look, because it doesn't make any sense to me on the surface, but there's nothing in the Bible that's not there for a reason. So why did God need, or why did he want John the Baptist? Well, first of all, he wants him and needs him to the point where he starts promising John the Baptist all the way back in Isaiah. And the last few verses of the Old Testament in the book of Malachi are a promise that John the Baptist will be the next prophet that they will see. So from Malachi to John the Baptist, 400 years of nothing. And then Malachi says, the next voice you hear will be that of Elijah, John the Baptist. There was a miracle conception. You remember, it is John the Baptist's mother couldn't conceive, and then the father didn't believe it, so he was mute. Exactly right. He was mute until he was born. That all happened in Luke chapter 1. All four Gospels tell this story about John the Baptist, and Jesus then is baptized by John. And then Jesus says this about John. He says, among all men born of women, he is the greatest. Now, I'll get to that in just a second. Jesus is making a huge statement about John the Baptist, and I think it's important that we dig into it. So Jesus is going to explain John's role. He's predicted and prepared, Luke 27:26. But what did you go out to see? And he's talking about people who went out to see John the Baptist. Did you went out to see a prophet? Yes, I tell you, you saw a prophet, but you saw more than just a prophet. Because remember, his job was to make way, prepare for the Messiah, and then to introduce the Messiah. This is the one whom about whom it's written, I'll send my messenger ahead of you who will prepare your way before you. Now watch. He says this, I tell you this, and this is Jesus talking to a lot of people who were formerly disciples of John the Baptist. He says, I tell you this, among those born of women, which is all of us, okay, there is no one who is greater than John the Baptist. Whoa, wait a second, time out. He just elevated John the Baptist above a lot of folks. And John the Baptist, we know, it wasn't perfect, all right? But Jesus said, of everybody that's been born, this guy is the greatest. Well, wow, that was quite the compliment. But look what he says next. Yet the one who is the least in the kingdom of God is greater than he. Now, was he really talking about John the Baptist as a person? Yes and no. He was, but look what he says. One who is least in the kingdom of God is greater than he. Here's what he said. He said, nobody that's ever been born was ever good enough, the goodest of the good, the best of the best. They never, ever were able to be held righteous by their sinless life, because all have sinned. So as great as John the Baptist was, he still couldn't get into heaven based on his good works. But look what he says about the people who are in the kingdom of heaven. The least in the kingdom of God is greater than he. And that means those who entered the kingdom of God by faith, not in what they did, but in what Christ did, even the least of those will be in the kingdom of God. But anyone who tries to get into the kingdom of God through the law will fail. That doesn't mean John the Baptist is in hell. It just means that as good as he was, that was not going to get him into the kingdom of God, because that covenant failed. Pretty cool. John represents the end of the old covenant. When I say passing of the baton, changing of the command, the handing over of the gavel, that's exactly what we're talking about here. In Matthew chapter 11, 13, 14, for all the prophets in the law prophesied up until what point in time? Until John the Baptist, okay? All of the law, all of the prophets pointed, prepared us for the Messiah, pointed to the Messiah, told us about the Messiah. All of the prophets, all of the law, all the books of Moses, everything in the Old Testament prepared us. So it wasn't just John the Baptist. It was the law and the prophets all prepared us up until the last prophet, which was John the Baptist. And if you are willing to accept it, John was and is the Elijah who was to come. So John represents the end of the old covenant. The old covenant then was to prepare and introduce us to the Messiah, who has become our new covenant by his blood. For the law, old covenant, was given through Moses, but grace and truth came through Jesus Christ. Now Jesus summarizes all of this when he's talking to these, after he rose from the dead, he's walking on the road to Emmaus and by these two disciples, and they are just upset because they didn't know he had risen from the dead. And he talks to them and he says, beginning with Moses, that's the law, and the prophets, so everything that they were to do, which was to prepare us for the Messiah, he says everything, he went through all the law and all the prophets, and he explained to them what was said in all the scriptures concerning who? Concerning himself. They all will prepare you for me, is what he told them. And they got really excited about that. So how do we apply this? Well, the law, which is the water of the Jordan River, is now replaced by the Spirit. The law prepared the Jews for the Messiah, but Jesus has brought the Spirit, who now the Spirit's job is to convict of sin, and the Spirit draws people to him. Before, the law, you know, thou shalt not murder, thou shalt not, you know, do any adultery, all of those things, that would, those were there to convict people, to show them their sinful condition. But now that we have the Spirit, it is now not the law's job to convict of sin. The law is over. It's past. Matter of fact, the very first book in the New Testament was written by the Apostle Paul to the church at Galatia. And the Galatians, he just goes on and on the whole book about don't fall back to the law. The law is yesterday. The law is over. The law was the old covenant. You are under a different covenant. Well, the Spirit is the one now that convicts us of our sin, and the Spirit will draw us to the Lord. In the words of John, this is the way John sees things after Jesus comes out of the water. When his disciples said, so now what are we supposed to do? And John says this, you've seen him. He's the Messiah. I'm not worthy. I'm not powerful. He must become greater. And I must become less. And John is testifying about the old covenant. The old covenant must become less, and the new must become more. Jesus is the holder, the author of the new covenant. So that is why God wanted John there. He was the last of the Old Testament prophets. He passed the baton, not just to another prophet, but to the Messiah, to his son. Not for more of the old covenant, but for a brand new covenant. Pray with me. Mm-hmm. Father God, this is a pivotal moment in the history of mankind. You gave the law to Moses to create a people. And in that people, you proved to everyone that none of us possibly can keep your perfect law. And so you sent your son, because that was the plan. And he did keep your law. But then he died. A blemishless, perfect lamb was sacrificed so that by faith, we can be forgiven. And now, Father, we have a relationship with you that is not based on how well we do with the law. It would be useless. But Father, by only the performance of your son on the cross and through his ministry, through his life on this earth, we are now, by faith, through your grace, forgiven. And Father, that not only is a new covenant, that's good news. Mm-hmm. So thank you for your son. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Well, you're going to really get excited as we go through Mark, because he doesn't pull any punches and he doesn't hang around anywhere too long. He moves at a really quick clip. So join us next week for session number 2. Until then, stay well. Know that we love you. Bye-bye.
Bye.